Now, some people, they land on avoidant attachment style, which is what Elsa does, right? But for Anna, she's anxiously attached, meaning she wants so desperately to be connected.
Right.
She wants so desperately to be loved and to share herself with somebody and to have somebody else share themselves with her.
It's true love!
Whoa!
Welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist. I love the movies.
I am Alan Seawright, professional filmmaker, and I need therapy.
And this is a continuation of Psychology of a Hero. We're looking at The Frozen Chosen.
Chocolate.
Elsa and Anna, Psychology of a Hero is where we break down the emotional health, mental health, and relationship health struggles of our favorite heroes to show that we all got problems and there's no shame in getting some help.
And if you overcome them, maybe you can star in your own animated film.
Anna gets blasted in the face by her sister's ice powers. They take her to the Rockin' Rollin' Trolls, and she gets her memory erased. Elsa feels so guilty for almost killing her sister.
Sure.
That she says, I am a danger, I'm a threat, and just basically leaves Anna to rot. And then their parents die, and Do You Want to Build a Snowman? In some ways, it's such a silly song, and then it turns so heartbreaking.
It doesn't have to be a snowman.
No way, Anna.
Okay, bye.
Yeah, it's so cute until it's so sad.
Then the parents die, and Anna's just spent years and years and years, and the first time watching Frozen, thinking, come on, Anna, you're naive, and your desperation for love, it's a little much. And then we all went into quarantine for a year.
Wow, turns out that was maybe underplaying it.
Yeah, exactly.
Get me out. Let me out of here. Get me the hell out of here.
Thank you to today's sponsor, BetterHelp.
It's really important to us that you have a resource for therapy, because what we do on the show isn't therapy. Because therapy is personalized, it's individual.
Yep.
It's not something we can do here for you.
Yeah, we often say on the show, if you need therapy, get therapy. And this is where you can get therapy, at BetterHelp.
Yeah.
Because we looked long and hard at, there are a lot of options.
Yeah.
We chose BetterHelp specifically.
Who we trust for this, yeah. That we would refer people to, and here's why. So BetterHelp's gonna assess your needs and match you with your own licensed professional therapist. And you can start communicating like straight up within 48 hours. It's awesome.
Yeah, really quickly.
You can log into your account anytime, send a message to your counselor. Now, this is not a crisis line. It's not self-help. It's professional counseling with people who are qualified.
Yeah, and it's done securely online, so nobody can break in and learn your secrets.
There's a broad range of expertise in BetterHelp's 15,000. They have 15,000 counselors plus, 15,000 plus.
That's more than you.
That is more than me. They've got a broad range of expertise, which may not be available in your area locally, and it's available for clients worldwide.
BetterHelp is also committed to facilitating a great therapeutic experience for you, so they make it easy and free to change therapists if you're not satisfied with the one you match with.
Yeah, finding the right fit for you is everything.
Immensely important. I went to a couple different therapists before I found one where I really clicked and really started to feel like I was getting help.
Right, and so BetterHelp's gonna help match you to the right therapist for you.
You will also get timely and thoughtful responses, plus you can schedule weekly video or phone sessions, so you won't ever have to sit in one of those like uncomfortable waiting rooms. I don't know if you've been in the situation that I've been in where you're just like feeling judged by everyone waiting to go into therapy, like,
yeah.
What are your issues and what do you think my issues are and are we all crazy and what is going on here and why am I, and you just spiral into anxiety. It's a great way to start your therapy session. You don't have to do that now.
It's more affordable than traditional offline counseling, and financial aid is available for those who need it.
So awesome.
Yeah, it's super awesome.
BetterHelp wants you to start living a happier life today.
So visit betterhelp.com/cinematherapy, that's H-E-L-P, BetterHelp. And join over a million people who are getting professional, qualified help to address their mental health concerns and needs today.
We also have a special offer for all of you Cinema Therapy viewers. You get 10% off.
10%? Click, click. Booyah.
Bigger than I would have gone. 10% off your first month. Click the link in our description today and start getting the help that you need.
So for the first time in forever, we're opening the doors, we're opening the gates, we're letting people in. Anna hasn't really had any sort of socializing, except maybe with like the palace staff, right?
Yeah.
For all this time, and the paintings and the halls and everything. And in comes Prince Hans.
What an asshole!
I would never shut you out.
Okay, can I just say something crazy?
I love crazy.
All my life has been a series of doors in my face, and then suddenly I bump into you.
I was thinking the same thing, because like,
so, I've been searching. Lots and lots of door symbolism in this film. Obviously, we're singing a whole song about it right now. But there's doors everywhere, and they're closing and opening.
But with you,
but with you.
So one thing Frozen did, I noticed that right out of the gate, is it has songs the way people talk today. They say "cuz like" and "for the first time in forever." And it's very not...
Very anachronistic, yeah.
Yeah.
Although, what time period is this supposed
to be? Oh, it's not anachronistic to this time period or place, but
yeah.
Sliding on their socks and everything. So I hate and love that they gave us such a catchy, fun song.
Yeah.
For someone who's...
For someone who's a manipulative...
That's what I was gonna say.
I've never met someone who thinks so much like me.
Jinx! Jinx again! Because... Because you really don't want him to be evil later on, and I know people who have told their kids, oh, he wasn't evil when they sang this song. He turned evil in between so they could still, like, preserve the beauty
of the song. It's like, no, he's manipulating her the entire time.
Yeah, which is actually more powerful.
Oh, way more.
Because if you've ever been in love with a manipulator or an abuser, they started off charming.
This is what it's like.
This is exactly what it's like.
I dated a girl one time and she took me up to a waterfall and we sang a song and did a dance and made a little heart over the moon and then she destroyed me.
Pretty sure that didn't happen, but we'll talk about that later.
Marry me?
Can I say something even crazier? Yes!
Such, like, manipulator language, too. He reflects her language back at her.
Glad I caught you.
Manipulation. We talked about this in our with Dr. Stephanie Sarkis in our Mean Girls episode. Manipulation is just the dark side of social skills.
Yeah.
Right? You use the same types of skills to ingratiate yourself to people.
Yeah.
But you can ingratiate yourself to people because you like them and care about them and want to become better friends and get closer with people.
Yeah.
Or because you want something from them and you're going to take their kingdom and kill their sister.
Precisely.
In Hans's case, it's all about, one, he's got bad intentions. Two, it's an attempt to control. Anna is so in a perfect place to be manipulated because she is insecurely attached. Her attachment style, both from being shut out from her sister and from the death of her parents and being alone so long, she's landed on anxiously attached.
Just let me in.
Now, some people, they land on avoidant attachment style, which is what Elsa does, right? But for Anna, she's anxiously attached, meaning she wants so desperately to be connected.
Right.
She wants so desperately to be loved and to share herself with somebody and to have somebody else share themselves with her. That the moment Hans comes along and starts saying all the right things, she's right there.
Can I say something even crazier? Yes!
But Anna has incredible strengths as well.
I mean, they're kind of a mirror image of her weaknesses. She's so open, she is loyal.
She's my sister. She would never hurt me.
And she's incredibly brave.
Yeah.
And the bravery gets real close to naivete.
Yeah.
And then, you know. But she's willing to do anything to protect her sister, to take care of the people that she loves.
Anna's loyalty is both a virtue and a vice.
Yeah.
Right? It is a strength. Loyalty is a beautiful thing, but on the other hand, it's directly tied to her anxious attachment, to her need for connection, her fear of being alone. So she will do anything to keep people close by. The flip side of that, the beautiful side of that, is when everyone else is freaking out and thinking that Elsa is a witch and a monster.
Yeah.
Anna says she would never hurt me.
Right.
And she would never hurt any of us.
My sister's not a monster.
I really dig that because she is in love with Hans and not even looking at Kristoff that way, it allows them to actually develop a healthy relationship.
A real relationship happens on accident. Oops.
It's true love!
Whoa!
The best relationships are built on friendship.
Yeah.
They're built on trust and they're built on taking the time to actually get to know somebody.
Sure. Attraction at first sight happens all the time.
Yeah.
And attraction can lead to love.
Right.
There's nothing wrong with that.
You need to take the time to see if who the person you have attraction towards, who they really are, matches up with who you think they are.
Right.
And in the case of Hans, you know, absolutely not.
If only there was someone out there who loved you.
I love that Anna won't give up on Elsa. She's like Alfred in Batman Begins.
Oh, yeah.
Why do we fall, sir? So that we can learn to pick ourselves up.
You still haven't given up on me.
Never.
Anna's journey, she doesn't really know what love is. I mean, she has some experience with feeling loved from her sister when she was little, feeling loved by her parents, and then that was all gone.
Right.
And I don't know what type of relationship she had with the palace staff, but she doesn't really know or understand what love is. Frankly, it's Olaf is the one who teaches it to her.
Right.
Love is putting someone else's needs before yours.
Olaf, you're melting.
Some people are worth melting for.
And Anna, by being willing to give her life for Elsa, that's the act of true love. We talked about this last time. That is pretty awesome.
That it's not romantic at all. It's an act of sisterly love and protection.
Yeah.
It's great.
And I think Anna comes to see what love actually is.
I've got a sneaky feeling you'll find that love actually is all around.
It is sacrifice. There's a balance. Like, if you're only sacrificing for the other person and it doesn't go both ways, that's not healthy.
That relationship between Anna and Elsa is so great. And the differentiation that you see between the two characters, the most obvious is their color palette. Anna's hair is a warm color. Elsa's hair is, you know, stark white, basically. Elsa wears whites and blues and very cool colors. And Anna is always wearing warm colors, warm tones, earth tones. And Elsa gets all these, you know, amazing, like, power outfits with flowy things and stuff. And Anna is more often in comfy looking stuff. I mean, it's still very pretty, but it's, her stuff looks like things you could wear. And
yeah.
Elsa's stuff looks like things that you would wear on a red carpet and then never touch again.
Yeah.
All right, Mr. DeMille, I'm ready for my close-up.
Without Anna there to perform that last act in both films.
Yeah.
Elsa, it wouldn't have unlocked Elsa's ability to do the final little touches that she needed to do.
Yeah, because Anna's goals generally are unity and connection and our family being together and healing.
And Elsa is often isolation and...
Yeah.
I wanted to do Elsa as a villain therapy, but I got shot down. It's okay.
Well, you could.
It's a hot take.
What? And so here we see in Frozen 2, you know, once again, they're in a great place. But just like Elsa, Anna's growth in the first film was not a complete 180-degree change. She still wrestles with insecurity. She still wrestles with fear of loss and fear of abandonment.
Let me help you, please. I can't lose you, Elsa.
And she still wrestles with prioritizing. Like, when she straight up cuts Kristoff off.
Yeah.
Because she's so worried about Elsa.
Right. In case we die...
You think we're gonna die?
No. We will die at some point. Not in any recent time will we die, but way far in the future, we will die.
She prioritizes Elsa over her relationship with Kristoff and over herself and her own well-being.
Right.
You don't want me to follow you into fire, then don't run into fire.
She's still wrestling with insecurity, which I've found just when I think I've worked through my insecurities... There's another layer.
Right? Yeah.
You said you believed in me, that this is what I was born to do. And I don't want to stop you from that. I don't want to stop you from being whatever you need to be. I just don't want you dying.
But there's also some character work there where Anna is still very insecure and prone to take things as the worst way possible. So what I do like about Anna in Frozen 2 is when Elsa tries to go off on her own, Anna's like, no.
No, I'm coming with you.
Excuse me, I climbed the North Mountain, survived a frozen heart, and saved you from my ex-boyfriend, and I did it all without powers. So, you know, I'm coming.
I don't have superpowers, but I'm kind of a badass, and I got this, and we're making this happen. And then the most terrible thing that could happen to Anna, at least in Anna's mind, happens. Her entire story is, I don't want to be alone. I spent years alone in that castle. Now I have a man, and I have family, and I have Olaf, and... She pushes Kristoff away, Elsa pushes her away, and then Olaf just straight up dies.
Start? I don't feel so good.
And now here's Anna, and she's all by herself, and her whole reason for living has been taking care of the people she loves. And now even that's gone.
Olaf, Elsa, what do I do now? I've seen dark before.
So Anna may not have a superpower, but Kristen Bell has a superpower, and it is being the best on-screen crier in movie history.
Mm-hmm.
The life I knew is over.
And she gets me every freaking time.
Hello, darkness.
Did they base their animations on her acting, on her performance?
They have to have, because it looks... I mean, the facial structure is not the same, but the way her lip quivers and stuff is exactly like what Kristen Bell does.
To a place I cannot find. This grief has
like the way her lips pull back like that. There's a shot, this almost mirrors a shot in Veronica Mars. That's it's very similar.
But a tiny voice whispers in my mind, you are lost, hope is gone, but you must go on and do the next right thing.
I mean, there's almost no color in the shot, like no hope.
Yeah.
And
can there be a day beyond this night? I don't know anymore what is true. I can't find my direction, I'm all alone. The only star that guided me was you.
Whoever wrote these lyrics has been there.
Yeah.
How to rise from the floor when it's not you I'm rising for. Just do the next right thing. Take a step, step again. It is all that I can to do the next right thing.
Yeah, whether it's grief or depression.
It's too there. Much for me to take. But break it down to this next breath, this next step, this next choice is one that I can make. So I walk through this night, stumbling blindly toward the light.
Not a subtle sort of rebirth metaphor there.
But it works.
Works great.
What comes then?
Stepping out into a world that's her color palette, reds and greens, yellows.
Then I'll make the choice to hear that voice and do the next right thing.
Man, these lyrics hit so hard. And it's therapeutically sound. The concept of take a step, take a breath. You know, if you focus on the big task ahead, then you'll probably just shrink back into the corner of the cave. And just, I'm just one step, just do the next right thing, just do the next right thing. And the line, how to rise from the floor when it's not you I'm rising for. I think of people who've lost their kids, who've lost their spouse, who've lost other loved ones. People that I've worked with, people that I've done my best to help. And for so long, their life is about that person, right? This is why I get up in the morning. This is why I go to work. This is why I do this. This is why, you know, I do the hard things. And then what happens when that person's gone? And there's such power in these lyrics of just, that's a mantra. Just do the next right thing.
Yeah, it really is.
Like, you could literally just repeat that to yourself. I actually really like the simplicity of this one because it's all getting out of the way of the lyrics. The song is literally lyrics. There's some orchestration.
Yeah, there's some strings and
it swells there a bit towards the end, but mostly.
Yeah.
And it's not a song she's belting. It's a song she's emoting. And it's not just like we're talking about the loss of people, but it's also just like when all your plans fail.
Oh, yeah, you can grieve plans, you can grieve lost opportunities, you can grieve, you know, there's all kinds of things. I haven't had to deal with a lot of sort of close personal loss in my life.
If it's something you're passionate about and you want to dedicate your life to, and then it's not going the way you want, there's real loss and grief there.
Sure.
And the concept, no matter what it is, of put one foot in front of the other and just do the next right thing. Anna is definitely a hero. Yeah. You know, she's definitely someone to aspire to be. Hardship doesn't necessarily teach us things. At the beginning, she'd been through, of Frozen 1, she'd been through a lot of hardship. She didn't really learn much. But recognizing that we have something to learn. I think at the beginning of Frozen 1, she didn't think she had a lot. I don't think she was self-aware enough to realize how naive she was or how she needed to grow. And here she's realizing, I'm queen now.
Yeah.
What I like about her arc through the two films is she goes to a place of independence here.
Mm-hmm.
She still loves people, needs people. She doesn't close herself off to people, but she's not in this codependent place where one person needs another and the other person needs to be needed, right? Which is where she's been before. Here she's in this place of independence or interdependence,
yeah,
where she and the people of Arendelle are reliant on each other.
Our lands and people, now connected by love.
But she also she's courageous. She stands up to the Earth Giant. She does the right thing by breaking the dam, because she's got to do right by both people and the forest and her own people. And she realizes, like Thor realizes with Asgard.
Asgard is not a place. It's a people.
And I also love that she's accountable to Kristoff, because she's not perfect and she was kind of a punk to him.
Oh, yeah.
My love is not fragile.
But she shows nice accountability, nice humility, and nice ownership. She's a great character. I'm a fan. And I'm a fan of her growth.
Me too. And I'm a fan of Kristen Bell. Please at Kristen Bell with this. We want her to see it, because we want her to know that we freaking love her character.
Now, if you would like to develop the traits that Anna develops in these films, if you'd like
I would like to do that. Where could I do that?
To grow... Speaking of leading questions, to grow the way she grows, I have personally handcrafted strength builder guides so that you can actually apply application exercises for your life to develop these strengths and grow the way that they grow. And that's there on our membership site, which you can find the link for right here or here. And we want to thank you for sharing these episodes with your friends. It means the world to us.
It does.
So until next time. Some things never change.
Love is an open door. And
watch movies. that sounded like it hurt.
It did a little bit.
Yeah, let's get you some water.
I need some water.
Put them together, it just makes sense. Winter's a good time to stay in and cuddle, but put me in summer and I'll be a happy snowman.